Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Wake Up Missoula. I am your host, Scott Ramp, just double-checking some audio issues I just had in the morning, but of course I'm just restarting, and it's like it never happened. So welcome to Wake Up Missoula, and once again, I am your host, Scott Ramp. I have some weather for you guys. I have a lot to talk about today as well. It's first Friday. I have a lot of art talk for you guys, kind of guiding you for your first Friday events. Also, some of your Friday and weekend events, as well as some new programming happening throughout the weekend through MCAT. I got the very first Flagship Friday of the year. Flagship has started at Hellgate High School, so I have a nice little Flagship Friday video of the week. And of course, they're giving me another teen talk where they're talking about the old Mercantile and their what they think about this semester and how a couple of them are going to be graduating this year, but also how excited they are. I also have some, art clips, so you get the last chance to kind of check out what's happening at the Missoula Art Museum before they send that art on over to the 45th annual art auction, which will be happening this weekend. There's a lot happening this weekend for sure, and I'll talk more about this later on. I got Dubbin Stuff on a new day, and without further ado, here is a little look at your weather. It is currently 1 degrees outside. Your high is going to be at least 19. Your low is going to be 17, so it's not going to get too cold or too frigid. Probably right now it's going to be the coldest it's going to be through the weekend. Your high is going to be 38 degrees. Your low is going to be 32. And then your high is going to get up to 40. So things are going to start peaking on Sunday, but you're going to have that rain snow mixture happening throughout the weekend. And it's 80% chance of snow. And by Monday, you'll have that 60% chance of snow, a high of 34. So you won't necessarily have the rain mixture. You have a nice little snowfall going on here as well. So which means a couple of you, if you guys are planning on going up on the mountain trails or the snow trails, here is your guide from onthesnow.com. Blacktail Mountain Ski Area. You didn't have any fresh powder in the last 72 hours, but you can expect snow is there. So you guys can totally go skiing or snowboarding or snowshoeing or whatever you guys like to do on the slopes. Big Sky Resort had 6 inches in the last 72 hours, so it has some fresh powder. Montana Snow Bowl, you have 4 inches in the last 72 hours. Lost Trail had 8 inches in the last 72 hours, but it does have a little red warning. There might be some conditions that are not suitable for some folks. Bridger Bowl, you had 3 inches in the last 72 hours. Maverick Mountain, 2 inches. Discovery Ski Area, they had 8 inches in the last 72 hours, so they're looking pretty good. But of course, 6 of their 8 slopes are open and are in use. And then Showdown Montana, you had 4 inches in the last 72 hours. But here are some of the things that are happening in your local news. The Bitterroot Valley's own Bitterroot Bill predicted a warm end to the winter in a traditional lovingly ripped off of Punxsutawney Phil. But as you heard, the weather is looking pretty cold this year around, and this event was a way to educate youngsters. Originally, Punxsutawney Phil was predicted, well over 100 winners since the annual event began in Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania. Whether it was right or wrong, it was an excuse for people to gather in the winter to stay warm and see folks who they wouldn't normally see in the wintertime. This year, Punxsutawney Phil saw his shadow, predicting 6 more weeks of winter, while in the Bitterroot Bill predicted warm weather. And if you are from Montana, warm weather is winter. That's basically what weather is it's winter time. Maybe a little longer winter, but we're used to it. It's Montana. But in the state, 1,300 bison from Yellowstone National Park are going to be slaughtered sometime soon in a new deal that the Governor Steve Bullock lifted a ban on the slaughter. Recently, Governor Steve Bullock proposed a ban on slaughtering over 1,300 wild bison in the Yellowstone area. But with much negotiation, Bullock managed to gain 25 bison to save for the Fort Peck Reservation. Park officials say that they had little choice under a 16-year-old program intended to curb the animals' annual migration into Montana to prevent transmitting the disease brucosis to cattle. So it's the big deal is that they're trying to, you have wild animals, they don't want to prevent any kind of wild diseases. So that's what park officials have been saying. 25 of these bisons will be saved and under review, which means they'll check and see if they are sick or they could get possibly sick throughout the disease. They'll have this on for a year, and after that they'll be released to the Assiniboine and the Sioux tribes up on the Fort Peck reservations to be managed. No transmission of the disease from wild bison medicine to livestock have been recorded. According to researchers and livestock officials, that's in part because most of 5,000 bison were killed or captured trying to leave the park since 1985. And that's all you guys have in terms of just news and stuff. There's really nothing new really happening. There's a lot going on in the national circuit with Trump and whatnot, but it seems as though it's like if there's not really anything big happening, there has to be some kind of dramatic thing happening. And I didn't really want to talk about it too much in terms of national news. I did read a nice little article. I read an article on NPR just kind of predicting about how the GOP is talking about the ACA repeal and how they don't really have a plan and that kind of stuff, and how it's going to affect people who have health insurance through their job as well. So you guys can check that out at NPR.org. I got those stories from the Billings Gazette and the Missoulian. So you guys can check that out, Missoulian.com, and you can go to BillingsGazette.com as well to find out more information. Moving on, I got a nice little episode of Dubbin Stuff provided by the voices of me and a couple of the kids from our Saturday animation drop-in. So without further ado, who's Dubbin Stuff? And when we come back, I'll talk all about MCAT news.
Oh my god, letters! Oh man, I can't read. Oh jeez, I'm gonna have a tough time. What do they say? I just don't know. I think I might have like a paper or something that has something to do with these letters. Wait, what? I'm gonna write stuff down so I look cool.
I love smoking cigars. What? There you go.
An F? Well, this F better mean for fun. I just want everyone to know. Everybody, this F does not reflect on any of my fifth grade background at all. Really?
Huh?
Not one little bit.
You failed fifth grade?
At all.
Back to my flute.
How did your test go?
Nobody. What's going on? Hey, what are you saying?
Well, I think that I should probably
It's okay to admit that you failed your test.
That's why I didn't go to flute school.
Well, I didn't fail my test. I just forgot to study. What do you think I am, stupid?
Well, not everything's black and white.
Black and white?
Like this movie.
Here's the point that I'm trying to make with my finger. It's right at you. That's right. I need my stress ball, you know? But it's back there, so I'm trying to get an excuse to leave. So,
Oh, wait. You know, no, wait. We should talk about nowhere. Come back. Oh, man.
Now I'm not a part of the situation anymore.
Man. This is kind of awkward.
Alright, time to go back to my flute playing.
And that was a nice little episode of Dubbin Stuff to kind of lift your spirits through the weekend of cold and wintry weather. I have some more things to talk about as well. I got some new programs for you guys. This is provided from a media assistance grant from our MCAT.org website. If you guys are interested in being a part of MCAT in some way or some form, you could always go to our form selections. You can fill out a form and you can give us copies of videos that you've done in the past, as well as having us come over and shooting it for you. There's many opportunities for many organizations, both civic and nonprofit here in Missoula, and Missoula is a great place to have a bunch of nonprofits as well. So any nonprofit in town that wants to utilize MCAT as a television resource to help make some videos for your organization or future organization, we're more than happy to guide you and help you along the way. We also do some trainings that happen every single second Wednesday of the month. That's orientation, so you get an introduction of what MCAT's all about. A lot of it is a DIY, do-it-yourself DIY here at MCAT, but we have plenty of staff here to help you get things going and help you guys with this or that using Final Cut Pro. We don't have Adobe, just so you guys know. no Adobe, but we have plenty of cameras and equipment for you guys that you guys can check out at any time. The annual fee is $20 a year, and the first time a fee is also $20. So if you are just getting started, it's about $40, but you can always waive the fee by doing some volunteer work with MCAT if you want to do any like shoots or video productions type stuff as well, as a way to build up a resume or get into the television business. MCAT is a great place for you guys to kind of get a good start. And to get a hold of us, you can call us at 542-6228, otherwise known as 542-MCAT. You can also email us mcat@mcat.org if you're too scared to call us. But yeah, that's basically what's going on here. And so here are some of the programs that we make for a bunch of organizations here in town as well. And of course, I do want to mention that Dan Gallagher, one of our bigger contributors to a lot of veterans and folks here in town who are prisoners of wars and people who were missing in action, to honor some of our old veterans. He is a ex-Vietnam War veteran, or he was, because he passed away just last December at the age of 69. And we have a nice little video at the very end. His video, his full honoration of the Peacemakers Award was in 2012, and we are going to be running it this Saturday night, so you guys can look for it. And you can also log on to MCAT.org to find the video and watch it anytime as well on our video on demand page at MCAT.org. But without further ado, here are some of the things that you can see on MCAT this weekend if you guys plan on staying in and watching MCAT Channel 189.
But I reject the proposition that the Little Apple Dance incident was mainly about fun, because it's one of a number of policies in effect in Xinjiang that we could accurately think of as biopolitical. That is, what I mean by biopolitical is the Foucauldian definition. These are strategies and mechanisms through which human life processes are managed under regimes of authority over knowledge, power, and the processes of subjectification. There we go. So the idea is, you know, biopolitics is about moving people around and making them function in certain ways, perform in certain ways. Since 2001, the PRC has introduced a number of measures meant to limit, for example, the scope of the use of the Uyghur language. Uyghur has been all but eliminated from the educational system. They knew this was a ridiculous idea because there weren't enough Mandarin-speaking teachers for the school system, and yet they went ahead and did it.
So you do have what's called the blood-brain barrier, and the blood-brain barrier keeps out a variety of things that are foreign to the brain, but not everything. And so one of the things that you've probably seen, and we actually have some researchers at BYU and the University of Utah, because we actually have one of the same problems that you have in the winter with inversions. And the air quality in Salt Lake City is sometimes the worst air quality in the world, exceeding what happens in Beijing and other places because of the inversion that we get. And one of the really fascinating things that's happening right now, and you've probably heard this, nanoparticles. These infinitely small nanoparticles that are out there because of what we're doing to our environment, that may be doing some very interesting things to the brain. It's certainly apparently doing things to the lung.
I've seen many profound things in my life, but that has to be among the best. And I think that simple gesture of a woman who baked bread and shared it with the kids got expressed that day when I saw him carrying his mother back to her bed. So Dan, it is truly a privilege to be here on your behalf and with you today. You are an amazing human being in many ways, some of which John spoke about. But thank you for who you are, and God's blessing be always on you.
So I say, for all the soldiers and veterans and their families who continue to struggle with war and its after effects, Dona Nobis Pacem. For all who stand on principle, who work to make life better for their fellow human beings, especially those who work for the cause of peace, Dona Nobis Pacem. And for each of you, not just veteran or peace activists, but everyone everywhere who seeks to find common ground, who works hard for what you believe in, and who, in spite of obstacles and rejections, do it anyway. Dona nobis pacem. Dona nobis pacem. Simple phrase. Dona nobis pacem. Give us peace. Give us peace. Thank you.
Welcome back. And now it's time for a little segment I like to call Pre-Critic. So if you guys don't know what this is, I basically prejudge movies before I actually see them. And I base them on trailers or synopsis or basically just like passing by. I'm just like, oh, this movie? Oh, great. Love and space. This is this what we need. But it's not necessarily love and space. It's basically about a kid who is like, born on Mars, and then he falls in love with a girl he meets over the internet. It's like, in a way, it's like it's kind of like the biggest catfish around. So what's your favorite thing about Earth? You are. Oh, that's from the director of many hopeless romantic films comes The Space Between Us. Kind of like Monster Truck, where the pitch was like, I got an idea. How about, like, you know, like, the space between us is, like, literal space. Like, there's space between us. And there's, like, now, yeah, like, how are we going to do this now? And then they figure it out, and they just say, good job, Johnson. You're moving up in the world. Man. But your Bird in the Hand is Worth Two in the Bush movie will come out in theaters in 2019. It's going to be a great movie. It's going to be wonderful. But let's talk about this movie. Space kid talks to a girl via Skype and tries to convince her that he's ain't no catfish and he's from Mars and everything. But then he gets her to fit the bill to go on the kid's this kid's dad before the Earth basically kills him from Martian-born isms or whatever, something like that. Just to make stakes a little more interesting, he's on borrowed time as he's on Earth, makes this girl fall in love with him at the same time trying to find his dad. I'm assuming it's kind of bittersweet at some point because, you know, it's like one of those romantic movies. It's like, you know, I know, like, your dad didn't accept you, and he's like, oh, whatever, but, you know, I love you no matter what. And, yeah, this is movie. It's a space between us. Moving on, we got Rings, as if stealing yet another idea from James Cameron, comes the plural sequel to The Ring, which originally starred the voice of Lilo from Lilo and Stitch. There's a little side note for you guys. She basically played the creepy girl. I don't know who's playing the creepy girl now. She could be reprising her role. You know, she's still alive. Rings is about how a tape gets turned into a viral video online that if you watch it, a landline phone will apparently ring and then it will tell you that you have 7 days to live. And most of the time, I don't think there's like many landlines anymore. Like, unless you're like at a business, like MCAT 542-6228, you just don't know. It's ridiculous. You just, I'm assuming that you might get a text with a dead emoji followed by seven, and then wrapping up with some sunrise or sunset to represent days or whatever. Anyways, watch a cheap horror film that makes money, just enough to justify sequels. I'm assuming that the next movie will be called Ring Origins or Rings, the Final Chapter, romantic horror, wedding rings. You can just work with what you know. Anyways, moving on. You got Robert De Niro in another comedy. Here we go again. As we see a party grandpa trolling teens wasn't bad enough, watch Robert De Niro star as an insult comic that is going through hard times in his career. And where bullying has become a stigma, this movie shows that even the worst people deserve a chance to be president. Oh, no, sorry. I kind of trailed off there for a second. Anyways, watch this failing comic try to respark his career in this limited release movie. Let me guess, there's a lot of, like, you kind of empathize with him in a way. You learn to empathize with him. He's an insult comic, but then, you know, there's a bunch of people who are insulting him. He's like, you're not really that funny. It's like, I'm really trying hard. All right, moving on to the next movie. Uh, Well, yeah, yet another movie coming out. Never mind, that's well, thanks for watching Pre-Critic. You guys should check out Moonlight. It's very important from what I'm told. It's a really great movie. So that concludes Pre-Critic. I gotta get out of this before I kill myself. So without further ado, here is Teen Talk featuring the Merc and the New Semester for kids this year as well. So without further ado, here's Teen Talk.
I'm Neil Wells, and this is Teen Talks. Today on Teen Talks, the Mercantile and the new semester. Alright, so let's get going with the Mercantile. So, does anybody here have any opinions on the Missoula Merc? Yeah?
Dude. Jackson,
dude.
Say something.
Answer.
Say something. I think it's stupid. I don't think they should tear it down because it's a historic building, and even though it's not doing anything really currently, except I think it has historic value and it's really cool to go in there, and I feel like they should like turn it into a tour, and they can bring people
hey.
In and charge.
From my understanding, they're planning on keeping like the central hallway area as in like the new building as a historic area for the Merc.
Yeah, I mean the whole building itself is pretty historic, so I just think they shouldn't tear it down.
Yeah, exactly.
The tunnels are cool.
And they're going to turn it into some fancy smanchy hotel or whatever.
They're
going
to turn it back into a Macy's.
Macy's.
I like how you said that. Macy's.
Macy's. I wish. Anyway.
We're not sponsored.
No, we're not sponsored.
If they turn it back into a Macy's, at least it would still be there.
Exactly. I think, like, if they have to turn it into a hotel, why don't they just keep the building, but just turn it into one? Just do the inside if they have to.
That would be a motel.
Well,
yeah.
Oh, I guess
no
you're right.
No one wants to go to a motel in town.
No.
I guess you're right.
That's why that one place is going out. No, that place isn't.
Well, there's this,
Liz,
like,
do you have any thoughts on the Mercantile?
I guess I'm not 100% native to it, but mostly because it's, like, pretty historical. You said they were gonna like keep a hallway in it, like they were gonna tear everything down around it except for this one room.
What are they gonna do?
Basically,
like, have like walls on the ceiling and the floor of that hallway.
Yeah, I mean, I guess if they're gonna do that, it's not, I'm not like.
There's some interesting little areas in the Mercantile.
Yeah,
there's
a coal chute.
I don't think I've ever.
Yeah, there's like a bunch of little nooks and crannies that people can get to that are sort of blocked off, but not really.
My history teacher said that, like, the tunnels down there, they used to, like, set up stands to sell, like, booze because, like, during Prohibition. Because it was kind of
I believe that. Yeah. The basement is huge.
Yeah, it's so cool.
I don't know if this was for, I don't know if they did this, like, specifically for Macy's or if it was part of the original thing, but there was, like, a glass floor.
Oh, I remember that part, like, upstairs.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was kind of cool, but I don't think that, I'm pretty sure Macy's put that in.
Macy's.
So,
there's, like, a ton of holes in there.
Well, I'm still a newbie to Missoula. I've only been here for 3 years, so I have no thoughts on it.
I didn't know
what that building was until.
Owen doesn't know anything about Missoula. He's kind of a disgrace.
You're a disgrace to your family.
No.
You're a disgrace to your family.
I think
old Asian man talk.
Yeah.
I think we're gonna move on to our next topic.
My grandpa's not that old. For grandpa.
The second semester of school. So, what grades are we all in?
Oh, I wait.
So what year are you in
school? Okay, yeah. So did you mean to say grade or did you mean to say what class?
Just say it.
I'm a senior. Just kidding,
lies.
I'm a sophomore.
I'm a junior.
Lies.
No, I'm really a junior.
I'm really a sophomore, to clear that up.
I can show you my
sophomore.
ID card to prove it.
Sophomore.
Neil, what are you?
I'm a senior.
Are you sure about that?
Pretty sure.
Really?
Yeah.
Are you really sure about that?
Yeah, okay.
I think you're a junior.
So,
anyway.
How do we all feel about the second semester? Are we going to do it with a positive attitude?
Yes. Yes, because I got an engineering class, which
Ooh.
Is fun, with Hoover. And then I got...
Is that
dude,
seventh
you gotta
period?
Try the
no, I got a first period.
First period.
But it's still fun. And then I also got sociology and criminology, which is
Ooh.
Basically a free class.
It's
so
pretty
far.
Fun class, too.
Yeah, it's fun so far.
I've heard you get to tour the jailhouse and stuff.
I don't know. We haven't gotten that far. We're doing sociology right now. It's kind of funny, though, because we were doing this trivia on, like, the second day, and, like, our teacher would sometimes give us the answer. We'd be like, I think it's this one. And then we'd be like, nah, it's this one. She'd be like, put it back. And we're like, thanks for the answer. Thanks for testing our knowledge. But yeah, I like it. I like it. That's why
all my classes are the same.
Same.
Do we have that beginning
you
of the...
You guys are boring.
Do we have that beginning of the semester motivation?
That got caught on camera. We need to edit this out.
Do we have the beginning of the semester motivation?
No.
Such an angry...
No. There's a teenager.
Just my new band that Owen and I are gonna form. So yeah, that's all I'm really looking for.
You should just name
our
it
band.
That's already
a band name. Sorry,
band
no.
two.
Band two.
That's already
Reborn.
A band name. Also. Band was taken.
Band was the band.
It's off the list.
Username has
the
been taken.
Band plus band have been taken.
You should name. Oh, you should name it. We wanted like this. We wanted then enter name here, but it was already taken.
Oh.
Yeah.
We should tell
I. It wasn't. It's not technically mine, so I have no control.
Or
it should
be like
anyway,
the band name we wanted. It should just be like the band name we wanted was already taken.
Is this our like subtopic number three?
Okay.
No, it's still second semester.
Okay.
Yeah,
I like to say sorry, Liam. I was past my passes for being late. So you know how you get three, and then
mm-hmm.
if you're late again, you have to do like detention.
Mm-hmm.
That restarted,
John has a detention
so I'm
now.
Very happy about that.
It's going on your permanent record, Owen. You're not going to be able to go to college. Slacker.
I have a good reason for that. All right,
so
oh,
we
sure.
have to wrap up here.
Yeah.
So
well, you didn't even tell us about your...
Just Man. Tell us.
All right.
You look like you're
I'm getting out of high school soon.
I
are you excited
credit
about,
recovery.
Are you
dramatic music.
Are you excited that you don't have to take any more finals?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. All right. I'm Neil Wells, and this has been Teen Talks. Next time on Teen Talks,
the end.
Will Owen make it to class on time?
Nope.
Find out next time.
Spoiler alert.
See ya.
All right, that was Teen Talk with Neil Wells and a bunch of my kids for my Wednesday Hellgate High School flagship. So thank you guys for enlightening folks about what the teens are up to here in Missoula, even if it is just a little sliver of what the teens are up to. They're doing MCAT stuff. We do a lot of MCAT things with teens as well, not just teens, but a lot of middle schoolers. We're going to be doing Washington Middle School and C.S. Porter when flagship starts, which officially starts for the middle schools and every other school February 13th. So this one kind of started a little bit early because the one at Hellgate kind of starts whenever the volunteers like myself wanted to start it. So I started it right after they got done with their finals. In their high school, so I just kind of like just hit the ground running, just do it, and then provide you guys with a nice little teen talk just to get a perspective, and also to take a break so I can go to the bathroom during my show, which happens more than it should, and I gave you too much information. All right, moving on, we got some city council reports. So as I said before, in the beginning of the show, they're talking about a planting master plan in conjunction with the urban forestry master plan as well. The neighborhood planting plans represent a year's worth of meetings, public workshops, and work sessions by neighborhood volunteers and staff. The Park Bond reviewed the Riverfront, Rose Park, Southgate Triangle, South 39th Street, and Moose Can Gully planting plans at their November and December meetings at the University Planting Plan at their January 2017 meeting. So all sorts of, the last 3 months they've been working on this, also for the year, and then 3 months of workshops, which basically says, hey, you know, let's plant this here. Let's not plant that there, just so you guys know. That's basically it. So this is Chris Boza. He's the director of Urban Forestry, and he talks about implementing this plan in certain areas. So without further ado, here's Chris Boza. Wait, not that clip. Where was it? Okay, here's Chris Boza.
The neighborhoods took a different approach. Some of the approaches were very similar. The Rose neighborhood went so far as to identify 3 to 4 species for each individual street within the neighborhood. So once the plans are added on to the management plan as amendment number one, then that's what staff will utilize, for instance, when we're doing plantings, plant backs for tree removals in that neighborhood. When folks come in and they're, you know, doing a project, whether it's an individual home or an apartment or a business, then those will be the pool of trees that they'll select from.
All right, so that was Chris Boza. Once again, he's talking about some of the trees and stuff. The Urban Forestry Master Plan is to provide a certain selection of trees to choose from. Marilyn Mahler is concerned that we are limiting folks who wish to plant trees they want to plant. Not necessarily that's on the list, but also deviating from the list. So here is Marilyn Mahler, and she asks why it's important, also within a comment.
Plans was just to identify suites of trees for each neighborhood, and how did that become the focus, and why not just tell people what trees they should choose from? I mean, what basis are people choosing those species on? You know, I do a lot of work with plants and people, and sometimes they don't they want to know what to plant, and then they have other interests in it. Why the emphasis on, you know, spending all this time to come up with a list of 10 trees as opposed to some other, like, why is this such an important step, and were people excited about it?
It's important for one important reason is that you need to have a foundation on which to build your specific planting plans, if you will. And I'll use Moosecan Gully, for instance, and so Hillview Way. If you're going to do a specific planting plan for that corridor working your way all the way through, you need to have a plant palette that you would select from. And so that's the importance of what was done here.
All right, so once again, that was Chris Boza and Marilyn Mahler talking about how this this plan works, and how in some ways it doesn't work, but how they're working through it to kind of make it more available, make it easier for folks to be encouraged to plant more native and more kind of plants that are have the biggest chance of thriving in these specific areas that they've been doing research on. That's the basis of why they have this list in the first place. Urban Forestry has done some research on these trees that would thrive, but pretty much survive the winter and have a good lifespan, while at the same time not encroach on other native plant life as well. Chris talks about people who wish to deviate from the list in this next comment right here.
Option of going outside of the list, but just like any other tree planting that occurs in the public right-of-way, that requires a permit. And so if someone says, look, you know, I'm putting together this project and I'd like to deviate from that, we would look at each individual scenario.
All right, so basically what he just said is that you can do it, but you should actually be in communication with it. You just don't plant like a redwood tree, just like right there, and just like, here, redwood. It's like, oh, I didn't think that's a good idea. It's like, I don't know. I just planted it. And it's like, not so sure about that. So anyways, that's just kind of like just going over it. John Wilkins, he has his opinion about some of the trees that are in certain areas, especially some trees that can encroach on sidewalks.
And along boulevards, and especially if they produce even a minute amount of fruit, because I look over at the retirement homes off of Reserve, and all these crab apples and stuff start dropping down on the sidewalks, and people slip and fall on them. So you need to be very careful where you plant those, and maybe not close to a sidewalk.
Yeah, so that's one of the things that the city, and they're talking about this. This is a plan that's moving forward, and they're trying to get an idea of what works and what doesn't work, and the idea of just having, like, trees that would have falling crab apples, because crab apples are about yay big, about the size of a, not as big, they can get as big as a baseball, but usually if they're more wild, they're usually not as big, and it really depends upon, you know, how much nutrition the tree gets throughout the year, and a lot of times crab apple trees are every 2 years, so you don't necessarily know how bad it is 1 year versus another year. So that's just one of the things that I know personally because my parents have a crab apple tree. So, but that's kind of deviating from what the thing is. Heidi West thinks that there are some exceptions to some of the rules, and if some neighbors could opt out of this particular planting plan. So this is what she asks.
So I actually think some neighborhoods should be allowed to plant fruit trees in the boulevard. That's something that's pretty common in ours. I realize they're probably not city-sanctioned fruit trees, but they are beautiful, and we don't quite have the urban interface that some other urban forests bear problems that other parts of the city do have. So I would like to see an option for that. And I also was curious what would happen if neighborhoods just decided to opt out, because I think not all neighborhoods are entirely on board with having this restrictions. I mean, we have a tree list of 139 trees that they can choose from, so I don't necessarily think every neighborhood has to participate. And so what is a plan for a neighborhood that opts out, and how do they get their trees planted?
If a neighborhood does not have a plan, then we utilize the list of 139 trees.
All right, so let's move on to the next comment. I have a comment from, let's see, Chris Boza. And he talks about other planting plans as well, not necessarily just the one that's in Missoula, but some of the things, some of the other planting plans that other cities have implemented for their city and their the way they kind of map up their plan.
That one of the driving forces behind the planting plans was to provide some continuity within a neighborhood. This is not what we've done here is not the first of its kind throughout the community. For instance, the city of Philadelphia has 91 different neighborhoods, and they are just about finished developing specific planting plans for all 91 neighborhoods. There are some cities that will say, okay, we're going to have nine specific trees allocated for this particular street and for that particular street. The whole goal here was to develop a planting plan that met the requirements and the needs for having species diversity, and at the same time provide some continuity so that it would define a neighborhood, and to move away from the arboretum type of neighborhood where you could have 23 different species of tree, a complete mix on any given block.
So basically, it's a way for neighborhoods to have their own sense of area, sense of community. I mean, personally, what I think it would be very ironic is if that you're on a street on Pine Street and there's not a single pine tree on Pine Street. It's just kind of like very interesting about how neighborhoods, how they feel about certain trees, and with a list of 139 trees, it might be rare that there might be somebody wanting that 140th option as well to choose from. Marilyn Marler just wants trees to be planted. A lot of times this master plan can convolute some ideas on what people should plant, and this is she just wants trees to plant in general.
I support anything that results in trees getting planted, but I just don't know if this is this painstaking process of having people pick trees that maybe they're not even, like a photograph of the tree might not even convey all the information about the tree, and a lot of people in our town aren't arborists. So I don't know if it's using our limited valuable resource of volunteer time in the best possible way.
Okay, so I've noted that question.
All right, so that was Marilyn Marler, and she just says is that, you know, like you just heard, like she thinks for sure that she wants trees planted, but at the same time, she this process in she picking and choosing what tree to plant is kind of arbitrary in a way, but I don't want to like put words in her mouth as well. This kind of concludes what's going on with the Parks and Conservation. They're talking about this urban forestry planting plan that they hope to implement, and just kind of like it's supposed to be like kind of like a point of references. And I personally believe, based on my opinion, not to represent MCAT, City of Missoula Chartered Communications, all that stuff, is that you got to keep things native, because I don't want to, like, I mean, sometimes it's like you go to a town and you know, each I think that each neighborhood should have its own voice, and but at the same time, but if everybody's yelling at the same time, nothing really gets said. It's like you're down a neighborhood, it's like, oh, there's a willow, there's a weeping willow, oh, there's a fern, there's a oh, look, there's a giant a pine tree that's 50 feet tall, and then there's a whole bunch of little trees that are just kind of right next to it. It's like, oh man, that tree looks like it could be, like, if it falls, it could basically fall and like destroy like 12 homes if it falls. That's like coulda, woulda, shoulda talk, but here's a list of some of the native trees in Montana: ponderosa pine, Douglas fir, Lodgewood pine, western larch, subalpine fir, aspen, common snowberry, timbleberry, and I got this basically just online looking up just native Montana plants as well. With over 139 trees to choose from, I'm assuming that there will be at least one or two plants that you were thinking of that's already on the list. So just something to think about, and this is a master plan, and you guys can look up what all the trees are by going on to ci.missoula.mt.us, or you can look up at the Urban Forestry of Missoula. So moving on, admin and finance, we're talking about the Fox Management, Fox Site Master Development Agreement set the basic terms for several other requirement agreements to be negotiated. They're talking about a hotel labor peace agreement to protect the city's proprietary interest in the project for the risk of labor disruptions as conditional precedents to the city entering into a land disposition agreement, and as an ongoing material term of the master development agreement, the developer shall provide the city with satisfactory evidence that it has entered into a labor peace agreement between the developer, the hotel operator, if one of them to be selected, and any labor organization, that this has informed that the developer or its hotel operator that it will seek to represent the employees of the hotel. Labor peace agreement means that the agreement between labor organization developers and its hotel operator, if one has been selected, that includes a provision prohibiting the labor organization and its members from picketing, work stoppages, boycotts, and other economic interference against the project. This is very confusing. It's a very confusing meeting, and I didn't want to show you any clips because it seemed like they all kind of like argued and they kind of were talking about this and that. But a lot of this is just going through the preliminary stuff as they get into construction of a new hotel, a 200-room hotel off of the Fox site, which is just off of Broadway, right across from the St. Pat's Hospital in that nice vacant area. And one of the things is the city's doing a private, it's kind of like a private public ownership, but the main point is to build a conference center, which is going to be 29,900 square feet of a conference center that the city of Missoula will manage, but the Fox site will build. So in that way, they're trying to figure out a way so it works out best for everybody, while it'll be basically the Fox site will own the property. Around it, the city will manage the conference center. So that basically concludes all your city council stuff as well. I have an art clip for you guys. And like I've been showing you the last couple weeks on this, this is the last time I'm going to show this particular art clip, because as soon as this is done, All the art in the Missoula Art Museum will be gone or auctioned off, and this is your last chance to see a lot of this art before it'll be sold into private ownership for their 45th Art of the Auction. So without further ado, here's this, and when I come back, I'll have all your art in your art guide.
Experience in video production. MCAT offers weekly Saturday classes that spark creativity in kids from 9 to 13 years of age. Located downtown at 500 North Higgins. MCAT Saturday Drop-Ins. Create your story.
Senior Corps at Missoula Aging Services is Missoula's volunteer hub. Hundreds of volunteer opportunities await. You can help improve reading skills, school attendance, and the well-being of students, provide services that help older adults, or find out about countless other opportunities that will capture your interest. Because your heart's desire never ages, now is the time to reinvent yourself. Discover your perfect volunteer opportunity by calling 728-7682.
For too long, corporate tobacco has exploited our people, manipulated our practices, and profited from our addiction. No more. If you struggle with commercial tobacco addiction, call the American Indian Commercial Tobacco Quit Line today at 1-855-372-0037 and talk to someone who understands.
You're planning. If you plan to drink, plan to have a friend get you home. Get ride home ideas and tools at plantolive.mt.gov.
Hey guys, welcome back. Sorry about that. Just a quick little couple PSAs here and there, but let's throw it to some art stuff. So here is some of your art that's happening. Here is the very first Friday event that I'm showing you guys. This is Dale Marie Moeller. This is going to be Radius Gallery featuring the exquisite paintings and graphite drawing of Dale Marie Moeller. Moeller is a contemporary art realist painter with vivid, stunningly detailed depiction of animals, both large and small, offer unique, nuanced vision of nature's world. It is important to me to pull the viewer in and feel something. The next one we got, this is Lee Silliman Ghost Town Photos, February 3rd to the 25th, Gallery 709, Inside Montana Art and Framing is exhibiting Lee Silliman Ghost Town Photographs. These are prints that are 8x10 negatives from his large format camera and antique Western and vintage illustrations. Future So Bright, it will be at La Petite Autre. Future So Bright, it's new works by Marlo Crocfisso. It'll be happening at the La Petite Autre. Some small, tall, and new collection of works inspired by the absence of presence and sunlight at the end of 2016 and into the turn of a new year. The next one we got is Maxon McCarter, Astro Loki Lab. This is Join Bathing Beauties Beads for the first opening reception of 2017 works with artist Maxon MacArthur of Astro Loki Lab, including metal, forged bronze and silver jewelry, leather masks, and hand-forged swords and knives. That's the show that's happening at Bathing Beauties Beads, sorry about that, Berkshire Hathaway Home Service and Properties will be doing a nice little thing with, this is Tom Schenartz. This show represents the work of Water Media. Each piece tells a story that hopefully engages the viewers to recall some memory, real or imagined. The next one is a haiku collection. So I think this was really cool, is that this one guy sent over 1,001 custom postcards around the world with a poetry of haiku. So this is a nice haiku collaboration. It will be at the Public House tonight, in which... yep, all sorts of great stuff. Let's see. Experience the union of visual art and haiku in the series of 30 small artworks and that celebrate the experience, the changing seasons, quiet morning moments, and the realization that can be found in the rain beating against the kitchen window. That's kind of like the sense they want to give. Hal K. Luchuvaga. Was born and raised in Big Timber, Montana. Hal graduated from the University of Montana and lives in Missoula as a self-taught artist who draws paintings and many subjects. Join in at the Gecko Designs, and you guys can check out some of his artwork and even meet the artist from what it says in the synopsis. The Clay Studio is having a nature surface form content that is an exhibition showcasing ceramic work that explores the connection to nature in either forms of conceptual approaches. And that's pretty much it for all your art stuff. I'll go briefly over a couple of your events. We're running out of time for the morning show. There's Friday afternoon comic club. We'll be at the Zootown Arts Community Center. This afternoon at 3:30, Backcountry Film Festival will be playing at the Wilma Theater at 7 p.m. If you guys are all about outdoors, then do a nice little film festival at the Wilma Theater tonight at 7. ACDA Benefit Concert, the American College Dance Association Benefit Concert, is being held at the University of Montana, 7:30 p.m. Tonight. And I believe that's going to be at held in the open space. Let's see. It doesn't actually say where it's going to be. Huh. That's crazy. At the Glacier Ice Rink, they're doing Missoula Junior Bruins versus Yellowstone Quake. You guys can check that out. It's $10 for adults, $5 for military, seniors, and kids, 5 to 17. Doors open at 6:30 p.m. Saturday, learn to play hockey at Glacier Ice Rink tomorrow at 8:30 a.m. Community Forestry Day is at 10 a.m. Winter Storytown at Traveler's Rest. Shane Klaus will be talking. He's a singer-songwriter in Montana and says he's inspired by people and the world around me, particularly nature. Nature is unspoiled and brightened, yet brutal and unforgiving. And he'll be talking at Travers the Rest State Park tomorrow at 11 a.m. Once again, our Saturday drop-ins start at 1 o'clock tomorrow on Saturdays, and it goes until 5. It's $10 for kids age 9 to 13 to do some cool little stop animation. Once again, you can find out more information by logging on to wakeupmissoula.wixsite.com/wakeupmissoula to find out more about me and myself. You can go to mcat.org. That pretty much wraps it up. I'm sorry I couldn't get a Flagship Friday video, but I will get it next time. I'll save it for next Friday. There was a lot happening in this morning for my morning show. I just want to thank you all for joining me for Wake Up Missoula. I'm Scott Ramph. ¶¶